Happy Sabbath. It's great to be in God's house. Amen. It's great to be here in the Promised Land. I said that last week in Sandpoint, Idaho, and the Sabbath before in Rochester, Minnesota, but wherever God's people are and where God is, there's hope and joy and promise. Amen. Pleasure to be here. My wife Emma is in the back. And we were at this church one time before, and so it's a joy to be back here, and just pray that something said or sung this morning might be something God's Spirit can use to encourage you in your walk. You pray with me? Father in heaven, it's so good to gather together. We are honored to be your children. Lord, as we spend this time together, we choose to lift you and be drawn to you like you promised. In your name, amen. What God says to us is important, amen? But I found a song that says, it doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter where you've been, it doesn't matter what you've done, Jesus is softly calling, but because of who he is, because of where he's been, because of what he's done, you can start all over again. And this guilty burden you have had to bear has made your life so weary, though others aren't aware of mountains of mistakes you try to hide with a smile on your face. But a broken heart inside. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've done. Jesus is softly calling. But because of who he is, because of where he's been, because of what he's done, you can start all over again. Because of who he is, because of where he's been, because of what he's done, you can start all over.
I serve a God like that this morning. I hope you do as well. God of new beginnings. Every day is a second chance. Amen. What a great God we serve, and I just choose to lift him here in this place this morning. And I hope that as we've come together, this will be a house of worship, a house of praise, a house of fellowship and a house of joy. Amen? Two things I hope you get from this service this morning: assurance of who he is and what he's done, and the joy that comes with it. Amen? Two things I wish we talked about more as a church: joy and assurance. You can't have assurance without joy, and you can't have joy without assurance. And so I'm positive. I'm upbeat this morning. Amen? Even though we just traveled from New York to Seattle and on our way back, and I've seen more white lines than I want to remember. But it's a joy to be here, and we believe we have an appointment with the Lord here this morning. All right. I want to share some stories with you this morning. I call them parables to make you think and make you smile. I hope they do both. They help me introduce some other things that I want to share as well. A church decided to honor those in the congregation who had sacrificed their lives in the military. And so they had a very nice plaque designed and all the names on it. They hung it prominently in the lobby of the church. A little boy noticed it, but he didn't know what it was. And finally he said, "Mommy, who are those people?" She said, "Those are the ones who died in the service." He said, "9:30 or 11 o'clock? I hope all of you are alive and well here this morning. Amen? I get into a lot of churches and some very nice people come out to be at the concerts or the services like this. And they walk in, they sit down, they fold their arms, get a sour look on their face. They don't smile, they don't blink for the next hour and a half. Folks, I'm not sure that honors the Lord. I believe we have more to offer than that. Amen? And Bible says the joy of the Lord is our what? Our strength. And I think if we're weak Christians and weak congregations, maybe we need to bring a little more joy to our walk with God. I want to share a song right now that encourages me every time I sing it. Because unlike those who don't know God, we have his word and everything that's in it to benefit our lives and to bring us closer to him and be able to understand more of what he has planned for us. If you like a little Southern gospel flavor, that says, "God's word will stand." Oh, you're not running it. I am. She's pointing at the pulpit. I just claim senility, and now that I've retired, and it works pretty well. Down through the ages, people have tried to stop the power of God's word. They've tried to control it, even ignore it, anything so it could not be heard. But the word has survived, it's very alive, and still has the upper hand. Before we came along, after we are all gone, God's word will stand. And I've taken my stand with the book in my hand. It stood the test of time. It's weathered the storm while scoffers warn, threatening of every kind. The eternal survival of that old black Bible, its truth will never end. So whatever may come, when it's all said and done, God's word will stand. From the beginning till now, it's not lost its power. It's still God's inerrant word. And from cover to cover, it's still the bestseller of any book in the world. And there in those pages are answers for nations and truth to guide their paths. And whatever they decide, they'll surely realize that God's word will stand. And I've taken my stand with the book in my hand. It stood the test of time. And it's weathered the storm while scoffers mourn, threatenings of every kind. The eternal survival, that old black Bible, its truth will never end. So whatever may come, when it's all said and done, God's word will stand. Well, I've taken my stand with the book in my hand. It stood the test of time. And it's weathered the storm while scoffers mourn, threatenings of every kind. The eternal survival, that old black Bible, its truth will never end. So whatever may come, when it's all said and done, God's word will stand. So whatever may come, when it's all said and done, God's word will stand. Oh my God, God's word will stand. God's promises, you can't beat it. I don't know what the world does, you know, how they face every day, what's going on. Praise God for his abundant gifts to us, letting us know who he is and the fact that we can count on him every day. Amen? Amen. Young man was riding a bicycle. He had a knapsack on his back. And he rode his bicycle up to the border of Mexico. And the border guard said, "Welcome to our country. We're glad you're here. But I need to see the contents of your knapsack." And so the young man unzipped it and he poured it out. It was full of sand. The next day, the young man came riding up on the bicycle with a knapsack on his back. Same border guard, same gate. Border guard said, "Welcome to our country. Please show me the contents." Again, the young man poured it out. It was full of sand. He did the same thing every day for 6 weeks. One day, the border guard was off duty. He was walking through town. He glanced over at a little outdoor cafe, and that young man was sitting there. He went directly to him. He said, "Listen, we know something illegal is taking place. We haven't figured it out yet. It's driving us crazy." He said, "In fact, it's keeping me awake at night." He said, "Please tell me, off the record, please tell me, what are you smuggling into this country?" The young man said, "Bicycles." Isn't it amazing how something can be happening right under your nose and you don't have a clue what's going on? Folks, I believe those who don't know the Lord this morning and don't know his word don't have a clue where we are or what's going on. They can see the handiwork of the devil, but they don't realize that God's in control, first of all, that God has a plan, and God has told his people, "If you stick with me, we're going to get through it together." Amen? I'm going to praise the Lord this morning that he is who he says he is, and that we can become who he has declared we can be through what he's done. I'm glad this morning for the Christian perspective. My favorite story about perspective, though, is about the one about the snail. And the snail was crossing the road, and it was run over by a turtle. And they asked the snail, "Can you tell us what happened?" He said, "I have no idea. It all happened so fast." All perspective. Isn't it tremendous for us that we can see what's going on around us through the filter of God's word and God's impression on our minds through His Spirit. And so I want to celebrate the Lord this morning. He didn't need to bother with us. We made it pretty plain that we wanted to go our own way as created beings. And He said, no, I'm not finished with you yet. Great God we serve. You know, the enemy does not want us to enjoy our walk with God, does not want us to have fulfillment in this life at all. The enemy has made it very plain that he is out to get us, you know. Sometimes you feel like there are sinister things going on behind the scenes, and we're always keeping our eyes open. I think the devil's finished with that now. Now it's whatever he wants to do, it's out in the open. And enough people are falling for it and following it that we become more and more the enemy of him. And he continues to keep us occupied and keep our minds away from the things of God. He loves to bring the battles to our lives, keep us occupied, keep us distracted, keep us involved in things, just trying to keep up. And even though he brings the battles, I'm glad that the war has been won. A little more monitor, just a little bit. They stood before their accusers, suffering in shame. Yet they counted it a privilege to die in Jesus' name. These martyrs stood in victory and bravely raised their swords. Though they lost their lives that day, great is their reward. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Though we may suffer through the greatest pain, if our eyes are fixed on Jesus, whom we're fighting for, we may lose a battle, but thank God we won the war. He stood before the doctors, there was no more that they could do. Yet he believed the great physician could make his body new. But even if his Savior chose to lay him down, resurrection morning he'll receive a robe and crown. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Though we may suffer through the greatest pain, if our eyes are fixed on Jesus, whom we're fighting for, where we may lose a battle, but thank God we've won the war. Oh, if our eyes are fixed on Jesus, whom we're fighting for, where we may lose a battle, but thank God we've won the war. Christ, to die is gain. Though we may suffer through the greatest pain, if our eyes are fixed on Jesus, whom we're fighting for, well, we may lose a battle, but thank God we've won the war.
Oh, if our eyes are fixed on Jesus, whom we're fighting for, well, we may lose a battle, but thank God we won the war. We've won the war.
Praise the Lord. I was just thinking years ago, I used to travel and took 12 trips to bring all of the equipment in, the big box speakers and everything, and now it's right here. Who'da thunk, you know? I am electronically challenged. Somebody came up to me this morning at Ames and said, do you have things on iTunes? And I said, what's iTunes? So I really don't know. I couldn't even explain it to somebody. I'm not sure how it works or anything. However, I had somebody put all my music on an iPod several years ago, and he said, here's how to start and stop and change songs. I said, great. Got in the middle of a concert, and I hit the wrong button, and a 12-year-old boy in the back row came to the front, got me reset, and I am not lying. I had my first cell phone a year and a half before I realized you could retrieve messages. I had 150 messages. I had no idea. And my next cell phone I had for a year before I knew there was a camera in it. And now I got a thing in there that you can put notes to yourself. I have notes all over the place. I never remember to look at my notes. Now I'm claiming senility, and then I've retired, and that works pretty well. Anyway, mother went to the bottom of the stairs on a Sabbath morning. She called up to her son. She said, it's time to get up and go to church. He called back down, I don't want to go. She said, come on, it's time to get up and get ready. We have to go to church. He said, I don't feel like it. She said, well, I'm going to give you two good reasons why you need to get up out of your bed and get ready for church. She said, first of all, you're 47 years old. And secondly, you are the pastor. How many of you got up this morning and said, I'm going to church? How many got this morning and said, I'm going to worship? Not nearly as many hands for worship as for church. Does that concern anybody? Is there a difference? Big difference. A church is either a building or people. I don't want to go to a people service. No desire at all to go to a building service. I want to go to a God service. Amen. I don't think you can interchange them, because otherwise the first angel's message of Revelation would be, fear God, give glory to him, and church him. Doesn't work. Folks, the enemy has tried to steal a lot of things. He's tried to steal the Sabbath. He's tried to steal praise. Even simple things like calling the highest calling we have as created beings, worship, to call it something else. He wants to water things down and make things seem unimportant. I believe worship is too important for us to take shortcuts. Amen? We have 52 worship services a year. I don't believe we should ever take shortcuts on any of them. We need to make sure those times are special. And I often get a little concerned, and this is not a criticism, but I'll travel to a church and the whole service is honoring mothers on Mother's Day. Mothers are wonderful. I have one. She's 85, 86. And she just recorded a new CD. Still cranking. You know, you can't read her writing anymore, but she gets on the accordion and she's all over. Still singing very well. I've been to services where the whole time they were honoring the Pathfinders. No greater program than Pathfinders. I've been to services where the whole focus was raising funds for the new building. That's a great endeavor. But folks, those times when we come in to worship and we honor something else, it becomes a form of idolatry. We need to protect those 52 hours and make sure that they are totally God-centered. Just my own opinion, but I think sometimes we get a little well-meaning, but maybe a little careless. And it's easy to kind of divert from things, and the next time something comes along, it's like, well, we did that before, we can do it again. Just something I felt impressed to say this morning. Our time with God is so important. I do some worship services as I'm doing this morning. Most of the time, I'll do an evening concert, and I'll come in the morning and sing a couple of songs for the morning service. And something happens, it usually goes about like this. At the beginning of the service, a well-meaning person goes to the pulpit, bows his or her head, and says, Heavenly Father, we invite your spirit to come and be with us. I know that is sincere. I know that it sounds nice. I'm just not convinced it works that way. I don't know if it's because we pay the mortgage, we think we've taken over the building, I'm not sure. But I haven't figured out how we can invite God into his own house, into his own presence. He's already here. Amen? I believe it's the other way around. I believe the creator of the universe asks us to make a place to meet with him, and he invites us into his presence. It becomes so much more meaningful for me. And I've heard people leaving a service saying something like this. I didn't get much out of that today. I am also believing that's irrelevant. Our question should be, what did God get out of it today? Amen? I just shared a sermon recently on worship, and this is the best definition I could find. True worship takes place when God's people come together and give him divine pleasure. You like that? When God's people come together and give him divine pleasure. Worship is not about us. It's not about our personal tastes. It's not about our personal agendas. It's about him. Amen? And churches have split over what color the carpet it's going to be or whatever else. Folks, we need to be desperately holding on to the Lord and make sure he's the focus of everything. I have some friends that are very nice people. Raising children is not their strong point. They have two children. One was born in the spring. One was born in the fall. The two children are so jealous of each other and make such a horrible scene for everybody at birthday time. The parents have solved that problem by giving gifts to both children on both birthdays. How would you like to have something in your honor and somebody else get the gifts? But we pursue that every Sabbath, by the way. Every prayer you've ever heard in a worship service has this element. Lord, bless us in this service. Bless our time together. Bless us on this day. In all of my study, I have found no place where it says we come to worship to get anything. But the Bible does say, bless the Lord. Oh, my soul and all that's within me, bless what?
The Lord.
His holy name. It is not about us. And if we think it is about us, we're never going to have fulfillment in worship and probably never really going to enjoy it. And our life should be a gift of worship to God too. You believe that? Amen. A tiny little town They called it Bethany, just a village there, not really much to see, a place to which the Savior could depart when the world was closing in around his heart. Jesus loved that little town, for there he could abide with three who understood and stayed right at his side. And oh, the joy he brought that family when he raised their brother there at Bethany. Bethany was the place my Savior stayed to rest a while on the night before he prayed. A place that Jesus knew that he could go to be with people he knew loved him so. Anywhere that Jesus chose to roam, Bethany was the place he could call home. Savior, as you bring your love through me, won't you make my heart your Bethany? Billy and Dean were good friends. They played together almost every day. Now, out behind Dean's house was an old shed, and the boys played out behind the shed a lot. Well, one day, Dean was out there by himself, and he was throwing rocks around. And one of the rocks got away from him and went right through the window of the shed. He said, "Oh man, my dad's going to kill me." But then he thought a minute. He said, "You know what? Dad hardly ever comes out to the shed. So by the time he does, I'll have a good story." Well, for whatever reason, Dean's dad came home that day and needed something from the shed. As soon as he opened the door, there was the glass and there was the rock. His first response was, "Dean, get over here." Dean came running. He was not prepared. He had no idea what was going on. And he got up to his dad, and his dad said, "Who broke the window in the shed?" "Billy did it." And so Dean's dad marched right across the street to Billy's house. Billy's dad answered the door. He said, "Hey, Mel, what's going on?" He said, "Where's Billy?" He said, "Why?" He said, "He broke the window in my shed." And Billy's dad said, "Wow, when did that happen?" He said, "This morning." Billy's dad said, "You have no idea how interesting that is." He said, "Billy's been at his grandmother's house for the last week." Busted. Right? And there was weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth all the way back to Dean's house. Didn't take long for the punishment to follow the action. On this trip out here, we've had many occasions that we've traveled, well, it'll be 7,000 miles by the time we get home. And we have seen a lot of occasions where there are two vehicles pulled off beside the road, two of them, but only one of them had blue lights. In fact, we had one occasion where the speed limit up in Montana was 80. I was looking at 80. I was actually going slower than 80, but the guy who passed me was doing probably well over 100. And I thought to myself, where are the cops when you had this kind of violation? And 4 miles up the road, that car was pulled off the road with adjoining blue lights. Wasn't taking long for his action to be followed by the punishment, you know. I don't think that car was worthy of going 20. It was mostly rust, but the state trooper was speaking with him. Didn't take long for the punishment to follow the action. We have a lot of occasions in our lives, whether we call them our mistakes or our bad choices or committing our sins. We have situations where we have the consequences. We have the punishments. And unfortunately, we often equate that same thought process with the judgment. And I believe that's unfortunate because we have a lot of people who are afraid of the judgment. And I believe God's people should have no fear of the judgment. Amen? Anybody here looking forward to the judgment? Several. Praise the Lord. If you're not, give me a couple seconds, all right? You can disagree with this if you like. A lot of young people, they fear the future so much from what they've been heard that they basically check out. If you don't have to listen to it every week in church, it's a little easier to handle. But I'll let this be an encouragement to you this morning. I believe the judgment can be put into one word. Grace. What kind of grace? Amazing grace. God's grace, right? First of all, I want to say that I believe the Bible says that love is the fulfillment of the law. Secondly, I want to say the Bible says that we are going to be judged by the law, and I believe that. So follow me. If every day I go to the Lord, I say, Father, I love you today. I'm committed to you today. I know you're committed to me. I want to walk with you. I want to serve you. I want to grow in our relationship. I want to represent you. I want every step to be closer to the kingdom. If I do that every day, haven't I fulfilled the first 4 commandments in my relationship with God? Then I say, Lord, today I'm going to be encountering people that I know, some I don't know. I want them to see you. Please fill me with your spirit so that I can show them what Jesus is like. If you love them today, I love them today. If you forgive them, I forgive them. If you accept them, I accept them. Make me your servant. Let me be your hands and feet today. Haven't I fulfilled the other 6? That makes sense to me. Now, if you and I approach the Lord that way, and every day we make that new commitment, and allow him to work in us and through us, haven't we become children of grace? And know what the Bible says about children of grace? There is therefore now no what? Condemnation. That says to me, when the judgment comes, the Father's going to say, you know what? You're one of mine. Come on in. Enjoy everything I've made for you. Did you know that in early Adventism, the judgment was compared to a wedding? Doesn't sound so bad, right? Judgment's going to be a joyful time for those who love God. And for those who want nothing to do with him, sad, unfortunate, avoidable. But we have the chance to let people know who God is and what he's done. Amen? I believe that. Let me share the greatest song on grace that I've ever heard. This morning, if you've ever felt that you're not worth loving, if you've ever felt you've done something God can't forgive, If you've ever felt you've walked too far from God to come back, give this song about 3 minutes and 22 seconds, all right? With only 3 nails and 2 pieces of wood, with a rugged cross Jesus made a way. Jesus built a bridge the only way he could, so we could live in glory land some. The Father's hand of grace touched the earth below, on the hill called Calvary that day. There he left his love for every mortal soul. It still is here and never goes away. Jesus built a bridge you cannot burn. No matter where you are, you can return to the Father's house today. There is always a way. Jesus built a bridge you cannot burn. Now remember when you were close to the Lord. Now you have fallen far away. And you think for what you've done, the Father shut the door. Oh, but he is here with open arms today. Jesus built a bridge you cannot burn. No matter where you are, you can return to the Father's house today. There is always a way. Jesus built a bridge you cannot burn. To the Father's house today, there is always a way. With only 3 nails and 2 pieces of wood, with 1 rugged cross, Jesus built a bridge. Love that song. You trust him today? You trust that what he did was enough to take care of business? So that every day we can wake up and say, God is real. God is in my life. And my life's in his hands. His word is full of promises. And in a group this size, I'm sure there are those of you going through some difficult times right now, and I believe God's word has an answer for everything you're going through. May not be the answer you're looking for. May not be one you thought of. But I believe God comes through every time. And so, I want to share a unique song, because in this, God is doing the talking. It's called The Promise. And I hope something in it will help you either be reminded or just have you give you encouragement. Or even better, have you trust that God has your best interest in mind. And that if he hasn't taken care of your problem already, he will. Or at least help you get through it. The Promise. These are in alphabetical order and I couldn't remember. Oh, here we go. I never said that I would give you silver or gold, or that you'd never feel the fire or shiver in the cold. But I did say you'd never walk through this world alone. And I did say, don't make this world your home. I never said that fear wouldn't find you in the night, or loneliness was something you'd never have to fight. But I did say, I'll be right there by your side. And I did say, I'll always help you fight. 'Cause you know I've made the promise that I intend to keep, and my grace will be sufficient in every time of need. My love will be the anchor that you can hold on to. Oh, this is the promise, this is the promise I've made to you. I never said that friends wouldn't turn their backs on you, or that the world around you wouldn't see you as a fool. But I did say, like me, you'll surely be despised. And I did say, my ways confound the wise. I didn't say you'd never taste the bitter kiss of death, or walk through chilly Jordan to enter into rest. But I've offered you heaven, and on this you can rely. And I did say, I'll dry every tear you cry. 'Cause you know I've made the promise that I've prepared a place, and someday sooner than you think you'll see me face to face. You'll sing with the angels and countless multitudes. Oh, this is the promise, this is the promise I've made to you. Just keep on walking, don't turn to the left or right. And in the midst of darkness, let me be your light. Man cannot separate us, we're gonna make it through. This is the promise, this is the promise I've made to you. Oh, this is the promise, this is the promise I've made to you. Amen. luncheon was planned in town. Two of the people invited to the luncheon were the local priest and the local rabbi. They were good friends. It wasn't long after they arrived that the priest hurried over to the rabbi and said, "You have got to try the ham." The rabbi said, "You know I don't eat ham." The priest said, "Yes, I know that, but this is the best I've ever had. You at least have to try it." The rabbi said, "I am not going to try it." Well, the priest wouldn't take no for an answer. He wouldn't let go. 10 minutes later, he was still pushing, and finally the rabbi said, "All right, I'll eat ham at your wedding." I love the delays. That was great. Where is your commitment this morning to what you believe? Where's your commitment to the walk the Lord has designed for you? I believe we need to be taking regular inventory of where we are in our walk with the Lord, because the enemy is more busy than ever. Amen? Now, I've been diagnosed with a terminal blood disease. And I've had to retire. Changed my life in a lot of ways. For 3 years, I did nothing. I had no oxygen, no air. I destroyed my own blood. And took a nosedive a few years ago. Kind of, the Lord helped me through. And then folks up north of here, at the Mayo Clinic, along with God's generosity, got me where I'm back functioning a little bit. Can't do a lot of things, but still get behind the microphone and lift him up. So, but I found just because you enter a new phase of your life, it doesn't mean the enemy's finished with you yet. He still knows where my buttons are. Still knows where to distract me and trip me. But praise God, he's not finished with me either. Here's what happens. If you and I every day don't renew our commitment as individuals, as families, as congregations, as a nation, one day you wake up and you say, "How did we ever get here?" Right? How did the enemy make things happen so slowly we didn't notice? How did he make things happen so quickly that we didn't catch it? How did we ever get here? We need God's presence in our lives every day, seeking Him with all our hearts. Amen? Absolutely. Let me share my favorite story on commitment with you. I tell this story because there's a lesson in it, but it's just fun. A ship was sailing on the ocean. The captain was surveying the horizon. As he looked off in the distance, he could see an island. As he looked through the binoculars, there was smoke rising from the island. When he checked the charts, however, said uninhabited. He said, "Something's wrong." He steered closer, he slowed down, he dropped anchor, he sent a crew in a small boat to the island. As they pulled the boat up onto the beach, they looked up, and there were three huts. They called out, "Is anybody here?" A man came running. He said, "I've been waiting 10 years to get rescued." They said, "Wonderful. Where's everybody else?" He said, "It's just me." They said, "But there are three huts." The man said, I know. He said, I live in that one. I go to church in that one. And they said, well, what's the third one? He said, it's where I used to go to church. That's one of my favorite stories of all time. I told that in a church up back east, and folks didn't get it. I said, folks, most people leave the church because they don't like the people. He's the only one there. Where's your commitment this morning to what you believe? Where's your commitment to the walk the Lord has put together and designed for you? I hope this morning that every day and every step is toward the kingdom. And one of these days, I like what somebody said a while back. He was talking about when Enoch walked with God. And Enoch walked with the Lord for so long and so far that one day the Lord said, you know what, Enoch? We've been walking together so long here, we're actually closer to my house than yours. Come on over to my house. No different what the Lord wants to do with us. Walk with him here. Live with him there. Amen? How much time do I have, preacher? Well, I have two more songs. Is that all right? Take his word for it. I like his attitude. I praise the Lord for tone-deaf people, you know. I wrote this song many years ago. I wrote it and sang it on a solo on one of my projects. But then a few years ago, I'd been getting to meet some of the Gaither groups and others, and I wanted some people to sing in groups to hear my song in group form. And so I decided to go in the studio and demo some of the things as a quartet. And I found three guys to sing with me. And then they found out I couldn't pay them. So I had to go in by myself. And so in the evening we did the high parts. In the morning did the low parts. And ended up doing some demos and a quartet. I did all four parts and wrote all the songs. And I said, well, this is fun. And it came out well enough. Made a whole CD, and we'll talk about that later. But this is from that project, a song I really enjoyed writing. Oh, I have to do it. It says, they followed me home. Like sheep have gone astray. Praise the Lord, he loves us anyway. He has to have our will for his plan to be fulfilled, to follow in his footsteps day by day. And we have lived our lives of sin, but still he says to us children, come on in. His fold he will preserve, that's more than we deserve. He can't wait for forever to begin. He will take us to the gate, then he'll lead us to the throne with a twinkle in his eye like we have never known. He'll say, Father, can I keep them? They follow. And lately I've been watching all the signs. soon we will leave this world behind. The Lord has promised scenes beyond our wildest dreams, and not just for a day, but for all time. He will take us through the gate, then he'll lead us to the throne. With a twinkle in his eye, like we have never known, he'll say, Father, can I keep them? They followed me. And very soon, our journey here will end. And Jesus will return, and we'll ascend. I've been counting the days till we're carried away. So let me remind you once again.
He will take us through the gate, and then he'll lead us to his throne. With a twinkle in his eye, like we have never known, he'll say, Father, can I keep them? They follow.
It was the second day of school. The teacher was anxious to get acquainted with all the students. She didn't know their names yet. She wanted them to get acquainted with each other. And so she came up with this idea on how to make that happen a little more quickly. She sent everybody home at the end of the day, and she said, now tomorrow is going to be show and tell. I would like all of you to go home tonight and find something you can bring back to school tomorrow that will help everybody else understand your religion a little better. And so the next day it came time for show and tell, and the teacher said, little boy, why don't you go first? He went to the front. He said, my name is Benjamin. I'm Jewish. I brought a Star of David. Teacher said, well, thank you so much. I appreciate it. Little girl over here, what about you? And she went to the front and she said, my name is Elizabeth. I'm Catholic. I brought a rosary. Teacher said, that's so kind. I'm grateful. Little boy in the back, how about you? He went to the front. He said, my name is Bobby. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I brought a satellite dish. Aren't you glad we had the technology to send the gospel around the world? Amen. Amen. By the way, in one of our publications, I saw a cartoon recently. It had four pictures, three churches with steeples and one with a satellite dish. It said, which one's ours? What identifies you this morning as a child of God? What is it about you, if someone only spends a few brief moments with you, they can realize something special is going on in your life? I believe the Lord wants us to be prepared for the ministry moments that come to us. Each of us is different. Each of us has different abilities and gifts. And we make friends, we can develop things there. We make acquaintances, we can plant better seeds. But when it comes to those times we barely brush past people, how do we make a difference? I have a friend, no matter what's going on, good or bad, she says, praise God anyway. That's ministry. I have friends, when they go out to eat, they won't touch their food till they bow their head and thank the Lord for it. It's being a witness for the kingdom. I have friends that when something difficult is going on, they just have the right word to say. That's a gift. I have others who just know when to listen. I'm not one of them. I want to fix things. I have friends that just had that reassuring touch. There is something special in you that God wants to cultivate and use in those ministry moments in your life. Ask Him to show you what it is if you don't already know. And let Him use it for the kingdom. He'll enjoy it. You'll enjoy it. And the person's life you touch will be grateful. Where does the Lord use me the most besides doing this work right here? These little stories I'm telling all morning, I'd tell them all over the country. I'm in the grocery store line. I'm getting my car fixed. You name it. I'm telling these stories. And then I let people know why that story is important in my walk with God. I'm having a blast serving the Lord. If you're not enjoying serving the Lord, let me share two things with you. First of all, check your commitment. And then check what you're doing. You may not be doing the right job. You get those two things straight, the Lord's going to bring possibilities and opportunities to your life more quickly than you can keep up. Amen? And by the way, I always like to say this. Your good preacher here is only gifted in a couple of areas. Jesus was gifted in all. Amen. If you want to see this preacher with unbound energy, turn him loose in ministry in those few areas where he's gifted. If you want to see him tired and slowing down and making excuses not to do stuff, have him doing a lot of work that he's not cut out to do. Amen? Somebody else here is gifted in those areas. Take that and run with it. And allow God's Spirit to work in you and through you. Same for his good wife, by the way. I enjoyed your story. Was it? And your mother. You told me your wife wasn't going to be here. That's right. Well, congratulations. You look like family. My mother sold Tupperware for years, and she asked me to go and deliver. She had a big order, and I went, and they thanked her for bringing her brother. And I hate Tupperware. I saw the name. I you look 11, so. Let me close this morning with a song that I heard many years ago. And I said, Lord, if I only get to record one more song, I would like it to be this one. It touches me when I sing it because it just puts into perspective how awesome God is and how insignificant I am. But then that makes me see how huge his plan is. The verse I like in this song the most says, you think he'd be tired by now, that his need to go would end. But at God's command, the Son of Man is coming back again. And this time, one more time will do it. From a throne to a manger to a cross to a grave, but always with the reason why this traveler couldn't stay. Love kept him pressing onward to fulfill his Father's plan, so he rose up from that empty tomb with death's keys held in his hands. He ascended back to heaven's throne, where his journey had its start, and took one more trip to earth to live inside this sinner's heart. Well, you think he would be tired by now, his need to go would end, but at God's command, the Son of Man is coming back again. And this time, one more time, we'll do it. One more time to leave his throne. And with one more visit planned, we'll join his caravan. With this traveler who has journeyed far, we'll all be going home. Be not afraid, the angel said, just like he now ascends. This same Jesus leaving here is coming back again. And this time, one more time, we'll do it. Oh, one more time to leave his throne. And with one more visit planned, we'll join his caravan. And with this traveler who has journeyed far, we'll all be going home. And with one more visit planned, we'll join his caravan. And with this traveler who has journeyed far, we'll all folks, it's been a blessing to share worship with this morning. Pastor mentioned if you'd like to take my music home, we can make that happen out there. Also, if you'd like to help provide for what it takes to do this, I know the pastor, I'd like you to do whatever the pastor says. But this morning he said, we're going to take up a little offering. The last time somebody said that, they did. Your gifts this morning will help us get back to New York and whatever other responsibilities we have. I get 15 miles a gallon on our conversion van, so it's going to be about 2.5 tanks of gas home and about $30 in tolls. And, you know, you understand what it's like to travel. So this morning, if you'd like to give, it'd be a great blessing. Any check needs my name on it. Any cash needs someone's picture. And if you want to give our credit card, we can do that as well. So again, it was an honor to be here. Pastor, thank you. And if we don't see you here again, can we meet you at the tree? Amen. God bless you. Thank you.
Did you guys enjoy the service?
Amen.
Well, next time I hear any complaints about my preaching time, just want to know that you proved to me today that I should make my sermons a little longer. No, this was wonderful, and you know, in most jobs besides pastoring, when you work over 40 hours, what happens? You get overtime, and so since you guys got a little extra today, we need to dig a little deeper and give a little more to Jeff, because he gave us so much, right? And so may God bless you. We're going to have a plate right there in the back, and then if you want to take the music, please remember, go ahead and take the CD. Don't send the check, because we don't want to get confused on who paid and who didn't. We're going to hound you down, and I've got a big hammer, and